Northampton Conservation Commission for the 28th of July, 2016. The commission is a group of unpaid volunteers who work to protect the natural environment of Northampton. We are concerned with the eight interests defined in the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act. Our duties also include open space acquisition and management. The Wetlands Protection Act and the Northampton City Wetlands Ordinance are the tools with which we have to work. We operate in a way that is consistent with open meeting law requirements. All meetings, dates, times, and agendas are posted in advance, and we invite public comment during our meetings. However, we ask the public to limit their comments to issues that are within our purview. Today's agenda includes a request for determination of applicability to determine if replacement of existing restroom structure is subject to the Wetlands Act or the Wetlands Ordinance. This at Elbow Park. A request for determination of applicability to determine if resurfacing, rebuilding, drainage structure, bridge repairs, tree trimming, and other maintenance work on I-91 is subject to the Wetlands Act. The state is not subject to the city ordinance, so it's over the Wetlands Act in that case. Request for determination of applicability to determine the construction of a single family home is subject to the Wetlands Act or the Wetlands Ordinance. This on Andy Avenue. Notice of intent for River Road retaining wall repairs. I want to replace the riverfront area, the bank that eventually abuts the road on River Road. This by applicants for Northampton review. Notice of intent for bank stabilization and stream channel structure alignment. This to take place just below the Sand Beach and Roberts Meadow Brook. Notice of intent for roadway reconstruction, including utility and culvert replacement. This take place on Audubon Road where it crosses Daybrook. Request for determination of applicability to determine the construction of an addition to a single family home is subject to the Wetlands Ordinance or the Wetlands Act. This on Woods Road. Notice of intent for trail creation, wildlife line reconstruction, invasive plant control, and periodic mowing. This at Broadbrook Coalition. And then a public hearing to amend the land use regulations for the Mill River Greenway to allow reasonable uses and legal enforcement for land use. And then a few other lesser items for which public hearings not scheduled, but things like approving the no-wake zone for Elwell Island, mail and staff issue permits. Let's see, did we have, yes, we did have minutes for, what was the date in June?
26th,
May. Sorry, May, that was the 26th. And we'll distribute it electronically. Okay to meet, if you have any modifications or amendments. And is there a motion to approve the minutes? A second? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. We'll ask if there's any general public comment, not specific to a particular case. If not, we'll move to the first case, a request for determination of applicability, determine if replacement of an existing restroom structure is subject to the Wetlands Act or Wetlands Ordinance. This at Wood Park. Please.
We're replacing the Dow bathrooms.
Start with your name.
Oh, my name is Sean Porter, Executive Director of Oak Park. The Dow bathrooms were built in the 1940s, so we're looking to replace them, upgrade them to ADA code. They do sit across the street from Bull Lake, and there's a small stream that flushes rainwater down from Leeds. So it is within that reason area. We are going to work with Weston & Sampson and put all the buffers and what is needed to make sure nothing goes into there. But it's basically exact same pad, exact same location, just taking one out and putting one.
Any questions from the commissioners?
So you're not changing the footprint of the building?
No, not. It might be a foot different, than, you know, by because it's a precast bathroom, but it's not going to be anything significant. I don't think exact measurements of it would be too down to that.
actual construction process or demolition and construction process?
The demolition will be, because it was built in the 40s, we're not sure if it's going to have asbestos or whatnot in it. That has to be analyzed because of the tiles that were used in it. But if that's discovered, it will be obviously asbestos abatement and then full demolition. And then the next product comes in, it's a precast concrete situation.
Nature of the demolition is going to be with machinery or?
I think a lot of, well, right now it's all for a park grant, so we're not even sure if we're going to be able to do it. This is all required by the park grant that we're applying for through the state. So we have to have your go ahead on that before we can get the go ahead from the park grant. But the demolition will be very clean. We do a lot of by hand, saving anything historic, and then beyond that, we'll be some machinery.
Are there pits there now under the existing building or is this
No, it's a, it connects to the sewer, but there's pumps that are located right in front of it that we that pump the, because it's a low spot in the park, to pump it up into the sewer system.
Is that going to change? Are you going to just have these holding tanks?
Yeah, we're setting up holding tanks inside, so use less water, do less, less of a strain on the septic, on the sewer system. Try to be a little more environmental friendly.
Sarah, any comments?
Not really. I mean, it's, it is within the riverfront, but it's on an existing footprint, so there shouldn't really be any disturbance. Do you know when the project would take place? Assuming you get the grant?
So if we get the grant, which we'll know in November, December, we have 2017 as a planning period, and then fiscal year 2018 for construction would actually occur. So this is, years out. So if we find anything when, you know, Weston Sampson comes in and does really final engineering plans, I would obviously come back. That was a good discussion.
Nothing to do with wetlands, but just out of curiosity, why the switch from men's and women's rooms to men's
rooms? It's just what everything has nowadays. It makes it a lot easier. We have a lot of events at the Dow Pavilion and other areas that sometimes are very male dominant or very female dominant. Sometimes lines form that are unnecessary, so I think it'll make it a little more equal for everybody.
Other questions? Questions or comments from the public? Motion to close?
Close.
Second?
Second.
All favor?
Aye.
Staff recommendations of issue of negative determination. It is certainly within an area of subject protection, but we moved one piece and saw another one. Let's see what.
Can we get the final plans?
Yeah, we have to do that.
I think that would be a good condition.
Yeah.
And if the staff recommendation could not be see the final plans, but to be notified at least 48 hours before the inspection.
Well, once we get
before the demolition,
yeah. Well, once I get the plan, I'll definitely give those to you and I can give you a timeline of whatever.
Okay.
Yeah. No.
I find that we accept that information to put in the plan we submitted.
And notification 48 hours.
I'll let you know even if we get the grant.
Good place to start.
Can
a
second?
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you for
your time. And since we have 5 minutes to, or 3 minutes to wait, is there any brief items?
If no one has questions about the no wait zone sign, that would be important. I'm going to do that now. So the tip of Elma Island is fairly close to the new dock at the Connecticut River Greenway, and people would like to fly by there as fast as they can on their boat, so we'd like to install a no wait zone sign just so that people can slow down and try to rest.
Would that have to be on the island or upstream?
It would have to be on the island. Or it's cheapest and easiest to put it on
the north side.
It doesn't have to be.
The north side of Elma?
Yes.
There's always a lot of debris piled up there.
We'd have to find a good spot on the beach that is fairly protected. And if there's a big storm, we will lose it, but we typically lose all of it.
Jeez.
You can find one, it's really, it would be hard to find one that would be visible and...
The city staffs the County River Channel Markers Commission, and they've already expressed interest in doing that. And it only has to be visible from the east side, because the west side is too shallow.
Do you need a motion or just sense of...
A motion, please.
Does someone want to move that there are the installation? Have a second?
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
So voted.
And then the Paddlers Trail camping update, we've talked about that a few times, that meetings in the past, the commission expressed interest.
That person came.
Yeah, so we agreed to be part of the Connecticut River Paddlers Trail. So we thought that a good camping spot would be at the tip of the island, but after going out there with a staff person from the, I don't know exactly where she's from, what agency she's from, but that's not a good place. There's too much debris, it would definitely be open to power boaters, it's the same way to place it, but it, so we identified a few spaces on the west side of the island that are fairly open, but also have some cover.
Would they require clearing, or is it...
No.
So they put a platform there, or something?
Much less flood.
They're gonna put what, small dock in or something?
Just a little platform to camp on.
Up on the island itself.
Yeah.
As I recall, no dock in the water, this is just a platform.
Yeah, there's a beach area where you can pull up and keep your kayak. Same one that I was where. Moving forward, no restroom facilities. We thought maybe, but we didn't think it would probably get the amount of access that would require. It is not getting over.
We approved this in principle last year, the year before.
Yes.
Revote, or is this just...
It's an update at this point, they'll have final construction plans.
We are at the next item, a request for determination about ability to resurfacing, rebuilding, drainage, structure, and grid repair, filtering, and other needs for the 991 subject to what is that. Sir?
So we submitted the RDA. This is actually, if you remember a few years ago, we submitted an RDA that's going to be some basic project. The determination was going to expire, so we filed again with the length of the construction period. So we'll be back in front of you for your review of the project. It's basically resurfacing. Interstate improvements through the length of I-91 through East Hampton and Northampton. This RDA is from Northampton. And included in that as well is tree trimming, which is beyond the footprint of the existing character. I could go through the different, cover all different things, pretty straightforward as far as what's going to be done. It's surfacing, paint, painting, touching the pavement markings, of course, the tree trimming. What's that? I'll answer that saying that there's going to be tree trimming all the way up both sides and ramps. It's going to be overhang, but it's also going to be line of sight clearing and for signs. It is going to be a minimum, but on an interstate that size or the size that size minimum is, 10 to 20 feet in places. So there is a good wide swath because of just the line of sight that you need to see the signs which are set back. So it's not, in many areas the fence is another 10, 20, 30 feet off, so that would be like a wide, full reestablishment of the original clearing, but this is a line of sight clearing.
Also in the eastern part of the state, it just goes to long for the
questions?
Do you conduct any sort of invasive species management? That, I know it's probably the most important thing, invasive species area.
Yes, yes. Over the years, there's been a number of different things. There's been, you know, herbicide applications. That's been very, very intermittent over the years. And there's also, UMass carried out a number of research methodologies up and down. NCTV is basically a lab laboratory. You can try steam, try different physical removal, whatever. In each project, we now have mandatory invasive species identification removal. There are a number of cases where, you know, you're working on something and you're looking at the other side of the fence and it's just got everything, you know, it's just kind of right over. But no, there is, if you had anything specifically in mind,
I was
feel
curious.
Free. No, yeah. It's pretty daunting sometimes. You know, like the real small awards, so it's coming up. I saw it in, actually last year and this year I saw it. It kind of mimics, it has the look of like a milkweed. You have a line of people picking and picking milkweed. It's actually very, very nice.
We have this methodology
written
down in the
end of the project. I mean, as far as keeping record of project. It's usually one or two things. What we have in the contract, if there's a environmental specialist or monitor as part of that contract, that person meets with us and we go and that he or she goes through with the contractor, points out those areas. If there's not that in the contract, myself or someone on the DOT staff that would meet and go over the contract. It's usually one of those two ways. There's other ways that comes into play too. There's say what application specialist that comes in.
Pretty straightforward.
Thank you.
25, a request for determination of applicability to determine if construction of a single family home is subject to the Wetlands Act or Wetlands Ordinance. Applicant is Patricia Abbott, Andy Abbott.
Hi, my name is Eric James. I was the applicant. Patricia Abbott is the owner of the lot, 40 Landy Avenue. You'll have to forgive me because I'm not really solid in the terminology. We are under the guidance to make the lot on 40 Landy Avenue applicable to Conservation Commission regulations with regard to plantings and with regard to site work and the location of the property to be built. We did submit to Peter Wells of Hampshire Design, who created what I believe you have in front of you. Peter also did have a conference, I believe, with Sarah to discuss what we needed to do. So we were ready, willing, and prepared to do that.
So this part was on the email because it came in too late to be included in the packet, but I can pull it up. The initial plan was just the conceptual building.
Right.
The only one. So this has some photos and then also a point slope. And if anybody looked really closely at this, the slope markings are backwards. The topo lines are right, but the wetland is not on top of the hill, it's on the bottom.
I saw that comment.
And it's only on this one.
Oh, it's on the newer one?
Yeah.
It's backwards? Okay. Is that the one?
Oh, because this one.
This one is correct. Right. The one in here goes from 220 up to the house down to 210.
Yeah, this one shows the house at 200 and then the wetland at 210, which would make sense. To the break in the slope where those existing forces are
going
to
reinforce.
Sorry, basically, I didn't hear.
It'll reinforce the end of the lawn area.
The new plantings. Slope toward the wetland, what kind of vegetation is there now? Does that show in any pictures down the slope?
It isn't grass, it's just...
Brush?
Brush.
That's just, it's totally unmaintained.
And the plan is to keep it unmaintained so that it will be approached by courses happening, so that it'll brush off of them?
No. Very level, just slopes right at the last 10, 15 feet.
I guess the question I wonder about is what constitutes improvement in this case, since there is open lawn.
So the improvement be those plantings?
Yeah, but you're also creating an impervious surface of the house and living activity nearby, and so how do you balance out which is actually improved?
And historically, at what point do we get more detailed plans? As if there's driveways and
what they're calling the impervious area, what's going to happen to the
patios and decks?
So would the house be located, house and driveway and everything that you would be building be located within that area shown as a building footprint, or would you think you'd have anything outside?
No, it would be within that footprint. Excuse me for a second. I think this is Mike.
Yes.
Yeah. This is Mike Lowe. He was going to represent us with a presentation. I'm just the sub.
Okay.
He's later than I thought, I guess.
Well, we were on time. So 5:55 start for this case. Sarah brought up on screen what I imagine you have on your...
Yes, yeah.
Board.
Sure. So the applicant filed an RFD seeking a negative determination to allow, presumably it's going to be a residential house to be built on this lot. Wetlands are in the back. I kind of highlighted those lines so it's a little bit easier to see. Landy Avenue's here. The wetlands have been flagged by Chuck Dauchy. They kind of traverse the extreme eastern end of the site. This is the 35-foot offset line. This is the 50, and this is the 100. The proposed building envelope is shown in this heavy line, as you can see on the screen. So we are proposing to limit the area where the building could be built here. Now, given that the majority of this lot is in the 100-foot buffer, you know, and you have the front setback, which is actually up here, I mean, there's little room to be able to build anything outside the buffer. Work would be, that would occur in the buffer zone would likely be the building of a house, maybe part of the driveway, and, you know, associated site work, yard, landscaping, and that type of thing. We are proposing to add some native plantings along that 35-foot line. These two large circles are existing forsythia, approximately located, which are seen in this photo here. Currently, mowing takes place, you know, right up to that shrub line, basically.
So we're proposing to add some native plantings here for wildlife value, cover, some food source to beef up that line. And then obviously, you know, that kind of shrub, new shrub line would be the limit of disturbance. So we're proposing to be, you know, pull that line back, if you will, and in its place, instead of mowed lawn, it would be native plantings.
And those shrubs would be, I'm wondering what kind of barrier, Downey or a former member would always predict that over time people will mow and that it encroach further in what is a protected zone. That's what we need to do.
Right.
For any?
Right.
No disturbance?
Well, what's two of the shrubs there that are specified are very fast growing. One is the red dozier dogwood, if you're familiar with those. They grow really rapidly. They get to anywhere between 6 to 10 even feet larger even. They're a very stiff shrub. And the other one is, it's Viburnum castanoides. It's listed here as Witherod viburnum, but I know it as wild raisin. It's also it's in the viburnum family. It's a native. It's another fast-growing large shrub, up to 10 feet. So I can't say whether these forsythia, it looks like they've been pruned over the years, because if you, you know, forsythia, it kind of does that. So it looks like, you know, those have been pruned to probably, you know, 6 feet plus or minus. So if this wild, I'm going to call it wild native shrub barrier, were allowed to just kind of grow and establish, you know, you can imagine that you know, they would form a clump that's, you know, significantly, you know, and significantly larger than these forsythia back here. The other plant that's specified, the third one, is a blueberry, which adds a lot of wildlife value for feed food, and cover as well.
What I wonder about Ken is that not this owner, this. 20 years ago, the new owner says, oh, great, take a brush out and push down some of the stuff. And that what we have often required is the replacement of boulders, which can then be invisible by being covered with
sure.
foliage. So it's not going to be able to take a brush out back there and push into the 35-foot zone, which by ordinance is invisible.
I can understand that. I don't think that the applicant would object to placing boulders at a specified interval to kind of mark that line.
You have to specify boulder size.
I can't, I mean, I know you've done it in the past, but I can't really remember.
I can't remember.
It depends on the situation.
Yeah, some is more likely than others to fight encroachment. Sticky about that. This seems less worrisome than that. Still, I think probably could have been something.
Yeah, and you've only got 50 foot width, so it wouldn't take too many boulders to make
it. Right, it's a pretty narrow lot. but I don't know if you want to tell us, I mean, you know, at what interval we can add it to the plan, or let us kind of figure out, within reason, what, how many we need, you know, whether it's, you know, 4, 5, 6, 7, I don't know.
I think we're probably wanting to specify something that there can be things that are not going to be easy for somebody mm-hmm. short of the bobcat to improve. Mm-hmm. And otherwise, they say, oh, look, I got a big dart that slows down. Something that's more or less permanent demarcation.
So in addition to the forsythia, what else is down that?
You know, I can't really say. I'm filling in for somebody tonight. I'm not familiar with what's back there, but there's a lot of trees back there. There's some evergreens. You can see the Norway spruce poking in over there on the right hand side. There's some birch back there, which is not long lived, but I imagine there's a lot of, you know, maples creeping in, a lot of maple saplings down there. You know, it's an untouched area, so whatever.
Mosquitoes? It's probably doing a lot to keep people going down here too much.
I don't see a lot of vines creeping up all over the place, which is a good thing, but you never know when that can happen.
Used to be fields, or when I was a kid, there used to be fields there.
It's still fields.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There, or if it's going to be, yeah.
Down at the bottom, it's all fields in the back.
Yeah.
With, you know, brush and trees and all kind, you know, it's grown up a lot since we grew up there. So since I was a kid, it's grown up a lot.
But there are rebutters along that same wetland area, so they can prevent the brush hogs coming from this property, but I guess.
We can only rule on the application that we had in front of us.
Exactly right.
Any other questions, comments, or questions?
Any expensive level coming in from the back, so.
No, I mean, the neighbors on this,
on the other side,
just south side of the avenue.
Any questions or comments by members of the public? If not, motion to close?
Excuse me, could I just say something?
Sure.
Probably not applicable, but Joe Gullis was the owner of this property. He passed away this past October. He was 97 years old, and he was a World War II vet serving 2 years in Ascension Island. And he bought this as a building lot, and he paid taxes on this lot as a residential developmental lot. Two daughters and the brother-in-laws are doing this as much in honor of him because he always wanted that. And I know it doesn't matter on your responsibility, but I felt I had to say it.
Thank you.
Well, while this condo meeting is still open, would you be against adding native plantings in that 35-foot buffer? So native species to try to encourage additional wetland habitat?
No, of course not. You mean closer to the wetland?
Closer, between the 35.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I think the discussion that we'll just have is, what can we do to make sure that under the ordinance, we need to make sure that there's an improvement will comply. And so we just have to just work that out.
Certainly.
Motion is made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? We are closed. So, Sarah's recommendation is that if the commission agrees upon to approve existing conditions, and that the house constructions are not negatively impacted, then the commission will make a determination. I think that seems right. My concern is, of course, in the open part of the area, so the good intentions of this owner, the owner of Overbay, or the subsequent owner, who doesn't see any particular barrier in there. So I'd like to see holders. My sense is that something like 30 inches or larger will be something that won't be using a room by a single.
3 feet.
Huh?
3 feet?
3 feet?
We said 3 inches.
Oh, I said 30.
Oh, 30 inches.
So yeah, 3 feet. Appropriate measure, but roughly 3 foot boulders, and I don't think, I'm not so worried about putting them close enough together so you can't hold between us because there's also to respond to the
boulder.
Decided on holder side.
Like 3 feet is, it sounds like 3 feet.
Yeah, I think that that's a reasonable.
Yeah, something the bobcat can move around, you don't need to bring in any equipment.
But you're not going to do it by a new owner with a lawnmower saying, get that out of the way, or get all the time.
And then I'd also suggest adding just being specific that the no build zone shown on plans remain vegetated and unmaintained, and that all work must be combined to be shown hypothetically.
Agreed, and I like Tim's suggestion that native plantings.
Well, I see that. I mean, the boulders are like an educational aspect of, you know, saying, okay, here's the end. But an improvement is really improving that. And so I would even accept larksen trees instead of the shrubs spread out over the 35. We're not, let's say, up to the 10-foot area. We don't want to go too close. But adding some trees that would be wetland appropriate habitat. Rather than just a sort of line, right? Then it would be sort of a line.
Sure, right, all right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then I would be happy with that. It's,
so, Alita, did that make sense to you enough to write it down? So we'll call that as a motion.
We're having a motion to issue a negative termination by checking box 3. Including standard conditions, and that the detailed house plans that were submitted prior to construction, plus 3-foot diameter boulders, approximately 10 feet apart.
Yep. Across the
35-foot line, with native plantings within that 35-foot line. Spread throughout.
To include trees and shrubs.
To include the trees and
shrubs. And third, with that thing? Oh, that the no-build zone.
Remain vegetated and.
Right, so the opposite of the maintenance plan.
Yes.
Motion to call during construction.
There is a sedimentary rock at this point, but it would be in the detailed plan.
Right. Now, we are showing this barrier here, and if we go into the 35 foot zone, I mean, do you want a barrier down slope of any proposed plantings? How do you want to work that? Or maybe that those plantings are hand dug.
And that the cemetery goes up during the building of that house.
But I think, yes, that the plantings, the native plantings in the 35-foot zone, not all the way up to the mountain's edge, that's just about being. Because they don't have to be large, they're going to be left to the children, so quite small. Anything else? There's a motion. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? So moved.
Good. Thanks. Thank you.
This is a notice of intent for River Road retaining wall repairs. Northampton DPW is the applicant that is going to take place along the riverfront area next to the River Road.
Just good enough? Good shot? Are you going to second the meeting, sir?
I don't think we have any reason
to do this.
No, I just got one. Yeah.
About 5-7 months, 3 minutes.
Oh, perfect.
Ready?
Welcome.
Thank you. Did you open the hearing? I was setting up a...
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I'm Tom Jenkins, I'm an engineer with GZA down in Springfield. This is Casey Collins, environmental scientist with GZA. David Valletta with the Northampton DPW is here representing the city, who is the applicant on the project. And we did file a notice of intent for this work. It's interesting to me because when I first moved to this area 32 years ago, one of the first memories I have is driving up River Road. I was living at the VAR, I was staying there temporarily, and I was coming back and forth between VAR and East Hampton. And it's such a really nice spot down through there. This is in August, this time of year. It's really nice and cool, dark and windy. It's a beautiful road. And I remember that wall that's there. It made a real impression on me. I remember somebody walking on it when I drove by, and I remember somebody walking beside it when I drove by, and it being in a really dangerous spot because the wall is right on the edge of the road. It's interesting to me that 32 years later, I'm in here talking about replacing the wall. But it wasn't in the best of shape 30 years ago. And it's gotten worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And it's gotten to the point where it's cost more to maintain it than it does to fix it. Especially when you consider that the city applied for and received a federal and state grant to pay for 75% of the work through a hazard mitigation grant. Through FEMA, ultimately, but it gets passed down through MEMA, Mass Environmental Management Agency, and then on to the city. So we have a great opportunity to finally do something about it. We've seen cones and traffic barrels out there for a couple of years now, since I think Irene or Floyd, when some major holes developed in the wall. And we got involved, GZA, with the grant application, and then that's a long process of a couple of years to get that approved, and now we're involved as the designers for the repairs. And, you know, we hadn't really taken a real close look at it when we made our application to MEMA, because it's really not time or need to have a really firm look at it, but the wall is 950 feet long. And we thought that it was probably right up against the water the whole way. But when we actually got it surveyed and evaluated the limits of the wetland resources, we found out that a lot of the wall is outside of all the resource areas except for riverfront area. Up at the northern end, the upstream end, the wall is right up against the water in places. And it actually is about 10 feet high, and the road is right there. And then as you go further downstream, the height of the wall decreases, and it actually moves a little bit away from the water, so that it's at the top of the bank, and it serves to retain the road, but it also is kind of like a traffic protector to keep people from going off into the river. I don't know when the thing was built and exactly what the history is. I think it predates CCC. So I don't know what the purpose of it was.
CCC?
Survey and Conservation Board? WPA, 1930. But what we found is that the last 400 feet or so really doesn't have much of a purpose other than to keep people from driving off into the river. So from a cost...
The course of the river has changed every time since...
I don't think so. I think maybe... I don't really know. Maybe they originally built it to retain the road, and then for whatever reason they just kind of went with the theme and carried it to the event. There's even one little spot where the land, if you're driving up the road, upstream, you have the road and the wall would be on your right, and the river would be
driving upstream. There's even an area where the land on the far side of the wall is a little bit higher than the land on the road. So the wall's really not doing much. All of which a long way to say that the replacement wall will not be 950 feet long. It will be in from the top. It's several hundred feet shorter than the existing wall. And the function that it provides for traffic control is going to be replaced by target. And we have some areas where we're taking the wall out and we're not replacing the wall. We're going to have riprap there right at the top of the slope, kind of in the footprint of where the wall was. And there's a lot of existing riprap and boulders between the wall and the edge of water now. Those are going to be taken out of place, replace the wall, and then put back in place. So, as I said earlier, most of the work's within the riverfront area. We do have to get into the river within the, below mean annual high water at the very upstream end, right where that, where the wall is actually almost touching the water. It's only a short section. We'll set up a coffer dam out of silt sack, giant super sacks, giant sandbags, or jersey barriers or whatever. They put the contractor to design that. We provided the limits on the drawings. And they'll get behind that and work. The water is actually, most of the time, it's actually lower than that, but it does come up, river's pretty harsh. We plotted the 100-year flood on the drawings, for the most part, except for that upstream area, the total wall on the outside of the 100-year flood. There is one area toward the south end of the project where, I'll know the history, there's an area there where the wall does, the bank is really steep right there. It's almost vertical. And the wall is crumbling and falling into the river. We're trying to figure out a way to avoid it, but we have a little bit of fill there to push that slope out. We're not putting the wall back, we're going to put the guardrail up, but it's just a vertical drop off. It's an indentation in the riverbank for some reason. We don't know why or what the history there is. But we're basically going to just make that a continuous slope. And that's one area where we are adding a little bit of riprap and boulders where there's not even that. That was a subject of interest. We are within rare and endangered species habitat, and as much of the northern corridor is. And so we had to send a copy of the notice of intent to Natural Heritage, and we got a response back from them. They asked some questions on the drawing about restoration and this and that. And so we provided a response to them, and that's what prompted the revised drawings. One thing that we noticed was in our drawings at the far south end, and near this area where I'm talking about where we're having a little bit of fill, area here. We had incorrectly portrayed the limit of work. We had it further down the bank when it's not. It's actually further up near the top of the bank. So we actually kind of over portrayed the impacts in the bank. So we're actually above mean annual high water with our impacts in that area. We had to straighten that out. They asked some questions about can you give us some more specifics on how you're going to restore the riverfront area, and especially this area up here where we're accessing and we're cutting some trees to provide a laydown area. There's no room to work there, so they need at least a place to store a couple of materials and maybe a piece of equipment. So we have a little area here that we're going to cut some trees. We're going to restore that with plantings and wetland seed mix and wildflower seed mix. So we've got that there. Actually. Conservation means, not weapons. Because we're actually not weapons. So we're actually going to use that seed mix and the restoration over all areas that are not going to be otherwise surfaced. So we just made that clear here. And then we have a planting table for the plants that are going to go up in that area. It's mostly red maple, box elder, green ash, cottonwood, shad bush, dogwood, nannyberry, and some herbaceous species, and some, and of course, some wildflower mix and populations. And then we also, we actually reissued all the drawings because when we took a closer look at them, we realized that we had some layers turned over that we shouldn't have. And it was, it wasn't affecting the technical information, but it was sure affecting, in our opinion, the graphical representation of what we were trying to convey. So we made some, we turned some layers on and off, and we just reissued all the drawings. We added some notes about the clearing and grubbing. If we're not going to be changing the grade, we may need to cut some trees, but we're not going to grub them out. We're just going to cut them flush, just going to grade, and not disturb the earth. And those areas, the stumps will just be left in place and allowed to re-sprout. That's the extent of the changes. As I said, the only technical changes had to do with additional clarifications on how we were going to restore the disturbed areas. But we did reissue every drawing because we had a couple of typographical errors and just some graphics.
They also asked an alternatives analysis for
they did.
Riprap alternatives.
And right.
I saw your written response. Can you walk through the thought process a little bit?
Yeah. Well, first of all, they were asking about, you know, bioengineering and that type of thing. And first of all, for the most part, we're not even really disturbing below the mean annual high water. We're just up on the bank. The bank now is riprap. What do you really call it? Riprap. It's boulders and shot rock. I would call it shot rock. It's kind of what they used as riprap before they kind of had control of a little bit where you get it all sent out. It's every bit of size you can imagine. And we're just going to reuse this. It's not really providing, the only thing it's doing is protecting the road. Because it's a steep slope there going down to the water. The water comes up mean annual high and even the 100 year, and then the slope continues up and then the wall's at the top. So, we got to move some of that stone and boulder out of the way to get the wall out of the way, put the new wall in, or put the guardrail in, and then we're going to put the same material back in place. But really, the city has a really low tolerance for risk. And there are risks associated with the bioengineering technique, especially when you got a road right there, top of the slope, sewer interceptor in the road. Not to take it lightly, but it's not an area where you want to have something to put in. And there's a risk with everything, right? But significantly reduce the risk just by putting back in what was there. And so the city evaluated that early on back in the grant application. We looked at it again when we were starting to design. That in this situation, it really had no tolerance. Very little, if any, tolerance for risk, especially since the feds have been 7 times.
It also seems to me that natural heritage was being this as if you would bring in a lot of riprap rather than reuse.
You know, it's funny that you ask that because in our, you know, there's the written correspondence, but then we also had some verbal discussions with them. And one of the questions that the reviewer asked was, how much additional riprap are you bringing in there? And so I looked at it, and the area down where I was talking about where it's really steep, we have a 630 square foot area. Now that's like, not well, depends on your point of view, I guess. It's 90 feet by 7 feet wide. That's near river. We have some areas where we have new riprap, but it's in the footprint of where we're taking the wall out, not putting the wall back. It's right there at the cusp where you're at the top of the slope, and we didn't want to leave that being such a steep slope. You're right there at the edge of the road. The road doesn't have curb, doesn't have drainage. All the water goes off and down the slope. So we didn't want to leave that just grass. And then all the other places except for a 135 square foot area at the very upstream end, where it's really already cobbles anyway. At the toe of the new wall, we're going to put in just a thin strip of riprap about 3 feet wide. So that's 135 square feet, 45 feet long and 3 feet wide. That's the only new riprap that we're adding to this thing. So we hadn't really portrayed it that way. When you look at it that way, it's
small portion.
Yeah, and so subsequent to all this, we did get a letter from them yesterday saying, okay, good, but we want to, I can't remember what it's called, but they want a turtle protection.
Sure.
And so we're going to work that out with them, and we'll put that in the contract documents for the construction work.
Do you widen the friendly road?
I'm sorry?
Are you going to widen the road?
No. No. Not at all.
Worried about pedestrians. So I wasn't sure what you're going to add.
That would have turned it into a whole different project, you know, if we had tried to add another 2 or 3 feet. And we figured, not that many people walk.
But you also limit my skates.
Yeah, you got rock on the other side. Yeah, it must be.
There is a nice bike path on the other side.
On the other side.
Exactly. There's a
go over on the other side.
The turtle management plan, is that during the time that you're doing work?
Yeah.
Is that what they want?
Yeah.
It's
yeah,
like
you know what
make sure all the turtles are out of the area and
right,
you sort of sweep it while you're working.
And they want the silt fence, you know, erosion control out of the way as soon as possible. Not have them hanging around any longer than they have to. So
that's one of my questions about what's the timing of this project?
Well, we're trying to go to bid almost immediately as soon as we get the permits in. And so we'd like to start this work right after Labor Day. It's a little aggressive, but. That's the hope.
And then to how long will it take?
Oh, mostly, a lot of it will be done by the end of the construction season.
Really?
If we can get a good quick start on it. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's only about 500 feet away.
Yeah. I drove past it.
And then a bunch of guardrails. So, yeah, no, it should go pretty quick. And, you know,
I was envisioning that you would have to wait until after winter to finish it up in the high water. Right now, it's great to get there in the water.
Yeah.
Okay. So ideally, you would get it.
Well, you know, traditionally, if you look at the statistics, a river like this, except in any hurricane,
yeah.
You know, fall, September, October, November, is a low period.
Yeah.
So, and the construction specifications will have all the language in there about you got to watch the weather, if it flashes green, if anything's happening, you know, get out. You know, get out of the above the 100 year flood plain and all that stuff. So, but that's the intent. Obviously, I don't think we'll have everything 100% stabilized before the end of the calendar year. The construction contract will probably run until the end of May, so that. Spring they can get out and touch anything up. The contractor will love this job because it's relatively quick and easy. It's not super technically challenging. And if they do it right, they can get in and get out really quickly.
You're not worried about the sewer during reconstruction. You don't have to go that.
No. No, we. In some places it's fairly close, but we're able to, I think we have a couple of areas identified where we're specifically calling out, got to provide lateral support here. But we're not going to expose the sewer or anything like that.
Other questions from the system? Any additional comments?
No, I would just add that now that the natural heritage comments have been received, we should add those to our commission.
Any comments or questions from the public? opposed?
Close.
And second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Natural heritage. Thesis. How should we best incorporate those comments?
We can do it for later. I would just add that also submit the turtle protection plan to us as well.
So you take one, two, and three.
Yep.
So staff recommendation. Conditions, standard conditions, add the natural heritage comments by Pendleton and request that the plan to be taken and turtles is subject to the condition of the board. Second?
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So voted.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You never say you'll find.
No, he's there.
Projects are so close to the end.
Yes.
Yes, we get them mixed up when we're talking about them in the office all the time.
They both start with R.
All both start with R and.
Four feet. Two inch thick packages that you guys have.
Oh, yeah.
We're using them to start for us.
You go, Sarah. I'm sorry.
Next case, notice of intent for bank stabilization, stream channel structural alignment. This just below the NCTV, and that is kind of tough. Also, the W intent is the same consultant GZ. It can't be GZ, what is the?
GZA.
GZA.
All right, well, for the record, I'm Tom Jenkins. Engineer with GZA, Jason Collins, Environmental Sciences, GZA, David Galeva, with Northampton MA. On this project, we are going to ask the commission to continue the hearing without a presentation. Surprise the development. We have because the work as proposed involves pushing some of the materials in the stream channel, moving them. Technically, that's dredging. So we had to get a dredge permit for this project, believe it or not. And we actually have that permit from DEP. We also need a general permit from the Corps of Engineers. And literally within the last few days, they've asked some questions. And we requested a meeting on site. They made some statements that they would like to see some other alternatives considered. And it's a little bit disappointing because none of the people that are making these comments have ever seen the site. And I think they had the impression that want to make crazy changes out there, and that's not the case at all. We want to push the material around in the stream bed, but the stream and up to the ordinary high water, it's going to look exactly the same. We have a situation in the bank there where we need to repair that and protect it against any future erosion in the future. And but we're working it out with them. And we're not sure if there are going to be any drawing changes or not.
We don't right now have an August meeting scheduled. What's your
time frame? That's the ointment. We're hoping to put these out together as actually one construction project.
It could be two projects.
Oh, for the same contract?
Yeah, for the same contract to do the same, the two projects at the same time. So it'll be one bid city would manage it as one project, but ultimately it would each be separate.
Two different permits.
Yeah, two different permits, two different funding sources. Same FEMA, but different years or different disasters. So we have to keep all of the numbers straight, but it would facilitate a lot of things. And for the last at least 9 months, that's the way we in the city have envisioned doing this. If everything goes right, we'll put them out together. All of this is so new, I literally, either yesterday or the day before yesterday, we made the request before, and then the other agencies to come to the site. Just look at the site, we'll talk about what your concerns are, what the alternatives could be, what we've looked at already, and then we'll sit down and the DPW offices will talk about it. We're trying to get them to come out. We're not sure exactly where it's going to go, because the drawings have been approved by FEMA, and if they make changes to the drawings, then they have to go back to FEMA. So this, I guess we think this is either going to resolve itself relatively quickly, or it may drag on. Now, in the event that it goes really quickly, we would love to be back here in a month trying to get a permit in time to, at that point, could even be out to bid, but not receive the bids until we can issue the permit as an addendum. But we're also afraid that if we open the hearing now and discuss the project in detail, that if we come back in August or we come back in September, the same people may not be here, and we may have forum issues and majority. So we just, in talking with David, we just felt like, well, why don't we? We have a pretty high degree of likelihood that we're going to at least make some changes.
Sarah, what's your sense that if we left it conditional, if it looks like it can proceed quickly, we try to call the meeting for August?
Are you here all of August?
I am only away the 6th or 15th, so we
Mason, are you around in August?
I don't go anywhere.
I didn't get back to your doodle poll because I have several things going on. I don't really have a lot of availability but during the week of the 25th. Very likely.
Yeah, the 25th looks like the best option.
That's the previous 2 weeks. That's really, I can say with just about certainty, I didn't get up.
So let's
hold
the contingent.
But on our calendars, let's hold the pending dates.
So continue until August 25th, possibly to be announced.
If in a couple of weeks, it doesn't look like we're going to have a quick resolution, let Sarah know.
That'll probably be the only case we can come in for.
If we are meeting in August, there might be a couple of things that we are
meeting. Okay. Did we have a motion to continue to the 25th? Next case, a notice of intent for roadway construction, including utility and culvert replacement, take place in the riverfront area for Gaylord. This is part of the road we're crossing the
Hi. Hello. Yes. For the record, I'm Melissa Cody from High Vaunt. It's the only thing on there.
That'll be.
I tried. So also, obviously, here tonight is Dave Paletta, on behalf of the city of Northampton. This is the city Utilities, Audubon Road, Utilities and Roadway Reconstruction Project. Filed the notice of intent for this work, for portions of this work. Our plans show the overall project from the intersection with Water Street in Leeds, and then a portion further out by Kennedy Road where the pavement's going to be restored. It's in pretty bad shape, I'm sure some of you know it well. Portions of the work are exempt from the Wetlands Protection Act. The utility replacement and the utility construction of the roadway, the roadway repaving within the footprint, and then the city is very proactively got an authorization for maintenance work under a generic order of conditions from the commission. So a portion of these activities is also already permitted with this commission.
Three set, okay.
So what Sarah is graciously putting up for me is basically the figures in Appendix A that illustrate essentially where the project is and what's going on. So in relation to some other features, just north of Roberts Meadow Reservoir, west of the river. Resource areas associated with Daybrook were delineated by City of Northampton staff. They're shown on our plan. Daybrook is a perennial stream. Immediately upstream of the road, just stand up and point if you don't mind.
Sure.
All right. So this is the area. So this is one of the areas of water main utility work and roadway reconstruction. This area up here by Kennedy Road is the other area of roadway reconstruction. And then replace the utilities up to the elevated water tank on the south side of Water Street. There's gray hatching. Checkmark hatching is endangered species habitat. Very fortunately, we're not in it. We also have no certified burrow pools anywhere near the project area. This is just an aerial view that shows a lot of forested area, especially in the watershed of Daybrook. And then residential development along the reaches of Audubon Road where the project will be occurring. So these are the plan views of the work where the project area where the work is subject to the commission's jurisdiction and the question of this notice of intent. Here's the intersection of Reservoir Road, River Road, Audubon Road, which continues down here. East to west, focusing on the Daybrook culvert area. And this is a close-up, a little out of order, but this is the rest of it. It's all kept in the same plan set for contract purposes. This is a close-up of the Daybrook culvert replacement. The existing culvert is in poor condition. There's some photographs in your application packages that show at some point in time, concrete-filled sandbags have essentially supplemented the bank in the culvert. It's 6 foot wide, 3 foot high. 30
years ago.
30 years ago would be the point then. So they've stood up very well. Daybrook comes in, flows in a southeasterly direction, joins Roberts Meadow Brook, and then the river. Historically upstream, there's a short, about 4 foot high, fieldstone wall slash weir, non-jurisdictional as a dam, according to the state dam safety regs, but still forming an impoundment, historically formed an impoundment on the stream. It shows as an impoundment on the USGS topo map. It has essentially filled in. Daybrook splits as it comes around the outer edges of this vegetated mound in the middle. The project includes the removal of a portion of that weir in front of the culvert. The primary reason for that is we think that when construction occurs, it will collapse. So rather than have it happen catastrophically during construction, we're planning for this event and including it in the work that the commission's reviewing. Because we are, even though there's very little impoundment capacity, we are, with its removal, we have included some riprap slope armoring to protect the embankment of Audubon Road there. We wouldn't want beneficial action to result in negligent effects on the road. So we want to protect that there. Flows through the culvert into a channelized stream. Again, fieldstone channelized, narrow, and about 50 feet downstream, it enters a 36-inch metal pipe out of private driveway. So the city's project area is generally limited to the roadway right-of-way. It's a very tight site. As you can see here, we have existing and obviously proposed utilities beneath the bed of the culvert, and we have a gas line above it. So we have to take into consideration the orientation and alignment of those utilities, as well as the roadway leading up to the culvert. It's been designed, it's a three-sided box culvert that's proposed. Again, 6 feet wide, 4 foot high, and 29 feet long. So the proposed project is essentially, it's replacing the existing culvert and slightly improving upon the openness ratio, the cross-sectional area of the culvert over its length. We received comments from DEP. DEP Western Region is very interested in stream crossings in particular, even more so culvert replacements, looking for opportunities to improve, to achieve the Massachusetts River and stream crossing standards. This is not the optimal opportunity to do that with the immediately located downstream restriction on private property that the city has no control over. This would essentially open up 50 feet of stream. But for the sake of responding to DEP's comments and further elaborating on the project, we provided a response to comments by email. This is one of the tables in that response. You know, basically with the culvert replacement as proposed, the width of it remains the same. It's the height of it that opens up slightly. So essentially there's no change in downstream flooding. But downstream flooding of private property especially is a particular concern when considering stream crossings. Again, limited downstream habitat due to historical stream channelization, residential development, and the site, particular site constraints. So basically what we're proposing is essentially an in-kind replacement with a slight improvement. And the cost of this particular piece of the project is about $100,000. DEP added their own table for a comparison of alternatives. In particular, they wanted to know what an in-kind replacement would do, or how it would look compared to something that meets the general performance standards for bank and land underwater, which are essentially the same if you replace bank with land underwater, the way they're phrased. And then one that met the applicable stream crossing standards. So again, the length, the 26 by 6 by 3, for an in-kind replacement, the minimum applicable stream crossing standards basically say meet these to the extent practicable. So in this instance, because of the site constraints, private property, existing utilities, particularly a gravity sewer pipe that goes beneath the culvert, gravity sewer pipes are very dependent on slope, and in order to make a much wider, an 8 foot wide culvert that would meet the openness ratio, we'd have to have bigger footings, deeper footings that would affect the depth of that sewer pipe, and as soon as you start changing that, you have to start chasing it out laterally. And
what is the, this is 20% wider than the existing bed, or where's the 8 foot coming from?
So, an openness ratio, is that a term sort of
familiar?
So, openness, stream crossing standards were developed by Scott Jackson out of UMass. People say in every presentation they were never intended to be regulation. They're from an ecological perspective, from a wildlife movement perspective, both aquatic and terrestrial along stream corridors. However, state agencies and federal agencies adopted these as part of the regulations. First, the Corps of Engineers with 404 and the general permit in Massachusetts, then DEP with 401, and now the Wetlands Protection Act takes it into consideration as well since the most recent revisions. Openness ratio is the cross-sectional area of the crossing. So length and width or higher square, whatever your structure is, by the length of the crossing itself. Animals don't like going into dark, narrow tunnels. So the bigger your openness ratio, the more likely you are to have wildlife movement through the structure. Another consideration is they like to move along streams. So it allows them the opportunity to maintain that route of passage without going up and over the road, or without deterring them from their natural movement patterns. One way to increase your openness ratio, get a better openness ratio, the goal is 0.82, is to make your culvert wider. So at the relative stream channel, you increase the distance from the stream channel to the sides of the culvert. Another way of doing it is making it tall, while maintaining a certain width on either side of the channel, because again, they're numbers. Problems with making it significantly taller, your road has to go up over it. Problems with making it wider, you need more substantial footings. You get to 10 feet, you need mass DOT bridge review, which is a very intense process and time consuming. And it's not always the most appropriate course of action at every site. So in this instance, with the property constraints, the utilities, the roadway elevations, the effort was put into making it, it can accommodate a slightly taller structure, and that's how we achieve the more improved openness ratio. If you want to, there's a second page to this table where they go through more of the considerations. The last one, of course, is because any project, especially municipal projects, no one has lots of money lying around. Basically, replacing it in kind and replacing it the way we're proposing it, it's essentially the same dollar amount. A wider structure, more materials, bigger footings, cost more, almost double, essentially. Plus, with a wider channel, we would be changing the hydraulic capacity of that and potentially causing a downstream flooding issue, which we certainly wouldn't want to do.
So basically, very little would have been
There aren't often many privately owned culverts this close to a roadway, but in this case there is.
What happens after the water goes in that privately owned culvert?
I'm sorry?
What happens after?
If it's channelized, so it flows in between properties and it's channelized. I don't know.
With a picture,
do you want to go back to the ortho photo? And then the photographs kind of show it going to a culvert.
The
right.
Okay.
One more. Go ahead, Glenn. So, this is DEP's MassGIS streamline. So this is essentially the channelized section. The driveway comes in here or so, and then again, it's channelized until it comes, well, it's pretty much channelized the whole way down to the Mill River, or joins Roberts Meadow.
Right to Reservoir Road.
Right, thank
channel
you.
Channel right to Reservoir
Road. And then it's a slightly more natural stream.
Okay, I got a question for you. You're going to keep that bridge about the same
way? One step at a time.
Oh, I don't know.
Once we finish the commissioner's question, then we open the
All right, I've never been on one
of these. So really, you know, from a permitting perspective, that's the meat of the permit application. This is essentially the rest of the project plans in case there are any questions about them.
I have a question on the 600-foot section that seems to be ignored.
Okay. Oh, further out by Kennedy Road?
There's big wetland areas on each side.
Yes, Clark Park.
It stops or begins at culvert crossing. I don't know if there's any drainage structures there.
There are no roadway drainage structures there. That section of road, the repaving is within the existing footprints. So they're going to reclaim and repave within that footprint. So that's exempt from the Wetlands Protection Act as a minor activity buffer zone that also gets carried over to the riverfront area there. This is the area we're talking about.
Just kind of scare up behind the surface.
Right, exactly, and repave within the same footprint. And then that activity is actually permitted under the city's existing maintenance order as well.
Sarah, you had a question about the use of riprap in the presumably upstream part of the...
Yeah, and we always like to consider whether there's any alternative to riprap. In this case, I'm sure that there's not quite a... That wasn't possible.
Right, the goal there is to have that angular rock holding itself in place and protecting the side slope of Audubon Road.
My question is about the removal of that weir upstream and the silt that might release, or I mean, how does that actually get done without solidifying the channel that's below it?
So we've included about 30 cubic yards of accumulated sediment removal from behind that. But that's based on the width of the channel and that includes the weir as well. There will be some stream stabilization that happens as a result. You're right. We're not expecting a huge slug of it to move, but the downstream, it will move through the downstream system. It just won't be all of it at once.
And what time of year is this likely to happen?
The goal will be to do the culvert work, obviously during as low a flow as possible. We've anticipated, though, that it may not be practical to do that during the Corps of Engineers regulatory time of year window for this type of thing, so we've included an application to the Corps for under the general permit to allow the flexibility. It's going to go out to bid, and I think David might be able to speak to the schedule better than I can from an engineering perspective. I'm sorry to be on the spot.
It's all right, no problem. The schedule is going to be somewhat dependent on the permitting from the Army Corps as well. It's a fairly substantial project, so although the intention was to try to put it out to bid this fall, I'm leaning towards actually bidding it later in the season when we get a good bidding environment and have the work start in the spring. There's some significant additional work that needs to be done out there in addition to the culvert replacement. It's still under discussion. If the culvert needs to go first, starting in the spring might not be a good thing. So, possible it might even get pushed out a little further, but that's still under discussion.
So to piggyback on what David has added, we've included stream bypass measures, temporary bypass measures during construction, from immediately above the culvert to immediately below the culvert, to allow for management of those flows as well. So that they're not going to do any of this work in open or flowing water.
Move part, you have to remove, cut down part of the road in order to build a bypass?
They can pump over the road.
They can pump over.
Mm-hmm. And they'll be discharging into that armored channel. And it's essentially the rate of flow that the stream conveys under normal conditions, for whatever the conditions are on that day.
That also the wear bypass on the
yes. Yep.
Is any of the silt going to be trucked away, or is it all going to be?
30 cubic yards will be. We've estimated 30 cubic yards as part of the removal, and that'll be.
So you say removal. That's
physically excavated and taken off site.
That includes the wear itself, or not?
Yep.
The wear and the sediment.
Yep. Exactly.
Questions from you? Comments or questions from the public?
I live right across from that. I've lived there my whole life. And that's why I asked, how wide is that going to be? Is it going to be wider than it is now, the bridge?
No.
No. So I don't understand why you're going to take the dam up.
The protocol for the conduct of the public hearings is you address your questions.
To you?
Maybe that's just artificial.
Okay.
You have to address your questions to us.
All right.
Then the applicant will often be the person who answers, but
okay.
Sort of the way we
I'm not good at this, but
no, it's not a natural process.
But you're right. The reason I'm asking is I don't see that why you have to remove the dam. I've always called it a dam. And the reason that dam silted in is because back in the 50s, when they ran the pipe from halfway down the hill into that pond, and filled it up with city sand. I bought the house from my estate back in 1989 or 1990, and I went to the city and I asked them to come up and please dredge that out, because it's a nice little pond. It never overflowed, it never did anything, it was just there, and it was just a nice little pond. I used to fish in it, swim in it, and everything else as a kid. But when they ran that city sand into there, it silted it in, and that's the silt she's talking about.
It's the sand from up the hill on
Auburn. City Street, yes, from sanding a road. It comes down a 12-inch cement pipe and it dumps into that pond. They used to be able to do that. You can't do it anymore. But I went to the sewer department and they said it wasn't their job to do that. I went to the water department, and in other words, I got played past the buck with. And now here we are today. The pond is filled in. There's no place for the sand to go. The pipe is plugged up. And now you want to take that little dam out, and I can't see any reason for it. It's only about 2 feet deep when it's full. It's a hard bottom pond. It was always a farm pond. The thing's probably been there 150 years. And I don't know, I just feel as though you're destroying the thing. It doesn't need to be done. I don't know why you would have to do that.
Well, we can only rule on an application before us, not on larger background issues about how the city has treated those. And from the perspective of a natural environment, removal of dams and return to as natural a stream that is possible is actually a positive thing. So we're generally not in the business of protecting previously man-made structures. So I understand your concerns. This isn't the forum in which we could.
Okay, I just wondered, because I don't see it as a danger, and there's certainly enough room to work around the thing and just leave it there. I mean, I don't see any reason to take it out, but I mean, you can't fight City Hall, is what I guess I'm getting, all right?
Well, what I heard from the applicant is that during the process of replacing the bridge and the culvert, that it's likely that that dam will let go, will break apart. And
it's not as flimsy as it's made out to be. It's not made with...
If you're looking for a reasoning, that's the reasoning that we were given. And that's what we have to go by.
But it's not made with flat stone or anything. It's made with big boulders and it's cemented together. And I'm 72 years old. It's been there my whole lifetime. And it hasn't gone anywhere. All right? The only time it changed is when the city decided they were going to drain that pipe into the brook. That's when it changed.
Other questions, comments?
Yes. I'm Bob Burnish. I live on 19 Audubon. The pond is on my property, so to speak. I've been maintaining it for... I pull the plug every spring, plug it up every fall. Don't know if you're supposed to do that or not, but we've been doing that. This house has been in my family for 100 years. I guess I would agree with him. I'd like to see it a pond again. And how would you go about doing that would be my question.
How would you go about
dredging the pond?
Not within our purview. Protection Act and City Wetlands Ordinance, those are the rules that we have to work with.
Understood, but there must be a process to dredge a pond.
If one were going to dredge a pond and identify a resource area, a wetland pond, a wind pool, whatever resource area, then that plan would have to come before us as an application. And we would then rule whether, in fact, the State Wetlands Act or the City Wetlands Ordinance permits it.
Understood.
We can't rule in the abstract.
I understand that.
Allowable or not until we see the plan.
Absolutely. The reason I bring that up is because if they take this, what she's calling a rock weir, which is it's a concrete dam, it's not rock, it's poured concrete. Once that's gone, I think all of my avenues are gone. If I had an avenue to try to have the pond dredge, I think my avenues would be gone at that point.
Well, what you're asking, I think, is more of a legal question, which is there a way to pursue a dredging project? It's not a conservation commission.
what complicates the issue was the, just about the whole weirs of the city right away.
Is it in the city right away?
Yeah.
We'll add maybe one more forward. So this is the roadway right of way. Sorry, I'm just changing the layout. And this is the structure. And I refer to it as a weir and not a dam because in the environmental regulatory world, that's a whole other.
I understand that, but you call it a fieldstone weir. It is a concrete or structure.
Okay.
There, to me, that's a difference.
Okay.
You know.
There's a barrier to the street.
The most worst that you can see, either right of way or.
Right here. This long double short dash line.
And the whole thing.
It's an unusual right of way that road is 99 feet wide that way.
And your assumption is that the, apart from any habitat or wetland or stream benefit to the removal of the structure, which has its own appeal, its own value, but apart from that, you're concerned that the work itself to rebuild this will be destabilizing of the existing.
Exactly. The engineers who have designed the work, their concern is that the amount of excavation that will be occurring in this area could also cause that structure to fail catastrophically during the work itself. And so rather than have that happen, they anticipate that it will happen and that it would need to be done in a controlled manner. As opposed to by chance. Exactly.
And since it's within the city right of way, that's not the removal of something that's on the other side.
That's my understanding, correct.
Other questions or comments from the public?
I have one more.
Sure.
I should address her. Has she been up there to look at this? I mean, I hate to do third parties like this. But
well, it's the way we have to just to explain. There have been cases where we'll have a room packed with 75 or 100 mm-hmm. people, and they get into arguments with whoever the experts are. We avoid that by having this kind of a structure that realizes it's artificial.
But has anybody in here been up there to look at that project?
Yeah.
You've been up?
The engineers that planned it.
Okay. My house is the one right after the little bridge on that side. And as that goes under that bridge, there's a stone wall. I don't know if you've noticed the stone wall that diverts the water into the brook. It's part of the brook, but it just makes the corner there. In that stone wall, there's a drain from my cellar. The house I was built in the 1880s, and there was a butter well in the cellar that never went dry. It's capped, and it's piped. And it goes into a pipe that drains into that brook, and it runs year-round. I just want to make sure that when they're doing that, they don't break that pipe off and not open it up again, because it'll fill the cellar up. And I just wanted to make it known to whoever's in charge of the thing that I'll show them where the pipe comes out.
Where is the pipe into the stream?
Yeah.
Where does it?
Right?
You said
it's at the brook level. Right at the brook level.
But downstream.
But downstream, maybe 6 or 8 feet from the bridge. Right, and it's beyond the, beyond my side of the brook.
David, is that discharge something that would be able
to? It's just it's an old red clay, you know, the old clay pipe, you know. But that's the drain for that well in the cellar, which has been there since they capped the well. Who knows when it was capped before I was born. and you can see when it gets this kind of weather here, you can see where the pipe runs in the cellar, runs into the sump and out to the brook. I know it does. So if they block that off or break that pipe off in the end, I'm going to be stuck. I don't know what the heck I'm going to do then.
Go down.
So that's a sump from your foundation?
Yeah, well, it's under the floor in the cellar.
And it's at a higher level than the street?
Yeah, it's about, I'd say it has about a, from the base of the pipe to where it goes into my cellar, it's probably an 8-foot drop, probably 8 feet. Because it's a pretty good distance. It's a good 100 feet away from the house itself. From the corner of my house to where it goes into the brook, probably 100 feet close to it.
Would you talk to the plan B tomorrow?
Mm-hmm. I guess you should probably talk to the DPW director.
Well, that's what I wondered. I mean,
it's not something that
if they're gonna work on that bridge there, they maybe take that wall down. They take that wall down, they're gonna break that pipe. And if they break that pipe, I'm gonna be in tough shape.
Are you talking about the wall?
On the downstream side, yes. If you're standing on the bridge, it'd be on the downstream side on the left-hand side or right-hand side of the brook. You can't see the pipe because it's behind a stone, there's a big stone in front of it. But I could show you where it is, because I know where it is.
Well, I think for present purposes, we've alerted city that there is a connection there. Is that connection on your land or is that?
No, it's actually on Mark Day's land. It goes under, it used to be Heehan's house. It goes under that, his land there and goes into the brook. But this goes back to that well, goes back to the 1880s or something.
You have a well in your basement?
It's capped.
It's capped.
I mean, they put boards over it and cemented the floor.
Well, that's not capped. That's
well.
It's covered. It is.
Yes.
It sounds like you should get a well professional.
And it drains out through that clay pipe to the stream.
Yeah, it goes into Well, you can see where it runs in the floor in the cellar because it's cold water. The cement is warmer, and then you can see the thing that goes right into the corner and goes right down.
If you have an active well that you're not using, you should definitely get it professionally sealed. That's not something.
Well, professionally sealed probably 60 years ago.
But then it is professionally, it's professionally covered.
But I'm at the base of the hill, so you get all that water runoff from the hill, comes right across. I mean, it's underground, but it's coming off the hill.
So it's groundwater finding its way
through
your basement.
Mm-hmm.
That is, again, not something that is addressable through the Wetlands Protection Act or the City Wetlands Ordinance. So you're not the body.
But that's why I'm here, to find out who I would see to alert them that that's there and to just make sure that the thing doesn't get broke off. I'll show you where it is if you'd like.
Any other comments from the
public? We won't break it.
Motion to close. And a second? All in favor?
So there's been habitat inventory on paper up, right? You know what upstream habitat? I'm just wondering what's going to be altered by the removal of that.
It seems like virtually all of the work is going to be in the city right away.
Because the stream flow won't shouldn't impact anything, it's not in this picture.
So the existing channel is not going to change, it's already cut into the silt, is that what you're saying?
Upstream here, it won't change. I mean, this area will change because of the removal of that mirror and the pond, but upstream is, shouldn't really change.
Are you talking about, are you talking about the mirror on the wall?
I'm just wondering what impact that can have on the natural environment of that weir when that is released.
Yeah, and it's filled in so much, I don't think we'll have much of an impact.
It is standing water above the weir.
Standing.
It is ground underwater above the weir. When the water, if you look at your pictures, you'll see the water going over the top of the dam. Of course, it's not doing that right now because there's not much water.
But there is a channel that the road comes up.
That is correct. That channel's probably 6 feet wide that comes down through. And it'll come down to a foot wide.
Yeah.
It'll get to it. That's going to happen.
It'll be narrow. I think the logical answer is to turn the stream. What's your concern?
I just don't know if that's an inventory to know what might be impacted by that removal. You've got a long-term structure that's... I mean, maybe there's no way to save it anyway because it's not salvageable.
Well, and the... staff recommendation says yes, this is the front area, exclusion supply, and from the discussion so far.
Watering or
Correct. Within the parameters of all applicable permits. We've approximated, we've given an anticipated bypass and dewatering setup. Copper dam above, copper dam below, create the dry work area, and then maintain flows around the work area. But the sizing of the pump, sizing of the pipes, that's the contractor's responsibility.
Okay. So we issue an order of conditions, standard conditions, no additional requirements or notification. Motion for the hours to get the report. And a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. Thank you. And as to the public question about is there anything to be done, that's outside the purview of this commission, but.
And when they put the pump location on my property outside of the boundary, what does that mean?
Pardon me?
The pump location is on my property where they're talking about pumping the water. It's outside of the boundary of the road.
You can adjust that.
Can you adjust that?
I don't think you can adjust that.
It's schematic, so actual measurements will be made in the field. It's based on survey. But we will find a way to work that out without violating.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We are now going to delay. Next case is request for determination of applicability to determine the construction and addition on a single family home subject to the Wetlands Act and the Wetlands Ordinance. This 103 Ridge Road.
I am Steve Silverman of Valley Home Improvement. I brought some visual aids. I have a poster board. Is that helpful? Just
sure,
hold
yeah.
up. And I have individual pieces. If that makes it easier. Let me make it really quick. Oops. So we're proposing to put a 24-foot addition off the back of an existing single-family with a deck. This is a plan view of the property to give you a sense of proportion. The shading here represents the wetland. Here's a cross-section elevation to scale showing the addition. We're proposing a silt fence and erosion sock 4 feet off of the end of the addition. And this is the topography of the property and the approximate location of the wetland, if you can read that. And then finally on the bottom panel is using Google Earth, we superimposed our addition and the house as it actually lies, representing the silt fence, and you get a sense of the topography again. I'm not sure how many people are able to make it out. If you can't see it so well, Yep, there's an existing garage right here, and this is the main residence, and then this is the addition, a one-story addition with a 4-foot crawl space. Yep,
yep,
right here. And this is the street, Woods Road right here. Took out a above ground pool that would be right at the end of where our addition is.
This is over
oh, thank you. actually ran that by Chuck Miller. When we were giving a presentation to the owners, we were showing other houses in the neighborhood, and that should not have been there. It's a
80%.
Yes.
It's not on their property.
The
assessor maps and these lines don't always.
Thank you. So I apologize. It was I've been since rectified that, but I forgot. Yes, sure. It's 24 feet. And from the end of the proposed addition, we believe it's plus or minus 55 feet to the beginning of the well. We're able to use, you know, it's not a large property, and we're able to use a mini excavator to dig our 4-foot frost walls.
I feel like I should know this, but where is Woods Road?
It is off Burt's Pit Road in Florence.
Okay. Jack, that property that we are currently working on is directly to the west of that.
Just on the main road.
It's right by your house. If you walk through the marsh and then go out and then go west. No.
Okay. Okay,
no. That's a, you mentioned small excavator, and it's a frost wall.
Correct.
Foundation. And looks like this, deck is really further away, but it's even more true. In this, the deck looked like it was the same size as the addition.
We have since scaled the deck back. It was originally going to be out further, but the homeowners realized they don't need such a large deck. So this is what we're going to propose to the building department should we get.
And it,
so the deck only comes out 18 feet past the back of the house.
Further away from the weather.
Correct. And that would be on piers.
Non-jurisdictional well that's part of the drainage for that area. So what MassGIS has at JS is pretty close to what it actually is. It's not cheap.
Well, isolated. So it's not a mortar gun detector.
Yeah.
Like you couldn't put the addition any place else without being either closer to the wetland or to somebody else's property or on top of the driveway.
Much larger wetland to the east, but that this isn't.
It doesn't affect this project. Okay. Any other questions for the commission? Questions from the public? Motion to close?
Close.
Second?
Second.
On favor?
Aye.
So, we have, need to actually see the complete and detailed plans, but other than that, negative determination, it is within the buffer zone, but not the official part.
Can I, create the, construction documents, which are just about ready? Should I be sending them to the Conservation Commission as well as the building department?
Yeah, please, for, us to be able to, see the staff to be able to review, because we're essentially reviewing this in principle, because there are specific instructions.
Okay, I have all those.
What's up here is how deep are the frost, you know, all of that stuff. Assuming it's gonna be fine, but we haven't seen it, so we can't.
Okay, I can send those over right away.
So standard conditions and, checkbox three, should be, so sort of just the boundaries are not.
And box six.
And what?
Box six.
So that's non-jurisdictional.
Non-jurisdictional. Is that a motion? And a second?
Yes.
Yes. All in favor?
Aye.
Close?
Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
One more.
We have a notice of intent for trail creation, wildlife park construction, invasive plant control, and periodic mowing. All, we're trying to carry it to Rock Brook. Bob, you here for?
Yeah. Actually, it's a joint operation of Rock Brook Coalition and Reed Silk Association. And, to give you a little bit of background, the city, I think, roughly 6 years ago, purchased a 100-acre parcel to the east of Haydenville Road, just at the Williamsburg border. And at that time, no many recommendations were made about how to use that land, but there was no organization which had taken responsibility for it, no friends group formed. And both folks from Leeds and from the Coalition thought it shouldn't lie fallow and unattended for all of its lifetime. So a little over a year ago, an ad hoc group of members of the Leeds Civic Association and Rubber Coalition started meeting and looking over the 6-acre strip between the Broad Brook and between Beaver Brook and Blue Pine, with the idea of both enhancing the habitat and making it a pleasant area for people to visit. There were several elements that we have discussed and thought about for some time that we would like to see as part of that area. We envision that the central portion of this 6-acre piece of the overall parcel, east and west of the Beaver Brook, would serve as a very nice picnic ground. So we'd like to put some picnic tables in there, clear up the debris. There's a lot of fallen wood and trees and so forth that can be cleared out of the way. We propose that two trails be built, basically, one to the north and one to the south. The one to the north would lead to a wildlife line close to, but not right on the Beaver Brook. Would provide a very nice viewing place for people to look out over the beaver marsh, essentially beaver, beaver marsh and the stream itself. And to the south, a trail would roughly, it's sort of a loop trail, it would roughly follow the contour of the Beaver Brook itself. We'd like to put a bench or maybe two benches along there for viewing out over the over the stream, that's the habitat there. It loops around past an old piece of farm equipment, a hay tedder, a horse-drawn hay tedder, and then passes close to a pool of water, which whose status is a little bit uncertain. It was investigated for its potential as a vernal pool by Molly Hale 4 or 5 years ago. She concluded that there were no obligate species that bred there, and it was probably not a vernal pool. And then the trail moved back to the central area. There's also a very, there are a number of artifacts in the area from the farm, which existed there until not all that long ago. And additional farm equipment and some smaller artifacts that were uncovered during our cleaning out of the area. We propose to have parking for visitors for the area on the grounds of the corrosion control facility. We've talked with the DPW about that, and they have essentially granted permission to use the north edge of the corrosion facility for parking 4 or 5 cars. We also would like to brush hog 2 areas of the of that 6 acre strip, which are rather lightly vegetated right now, and they serve as habitat for 1 species of special concern, wood turtle. The whole, practically the whole area, is priority habitat for wood turtle. So we've designed the brush hogging so that it would not take place during the time that wood turtles are active and foraging and nesting in the area. The last major portion of the proposal is control of invasive species. I think you, the Conservation Commission, actually considered this a couple of years ago, and some work was done by Lincoln Fish for 1 year with not very much follow-up. Some of the invasive plants in the area have been remained under fairly good control. There's wheat and, to a certain extent, Japanese knotweed, which covered one fairly large area. But it will need further treatment. There are lots of other kinds of invasive plants in the area, and it will need further treatment in the future to keep those under control and eliminate them to the level which is possible. So that pretty well sums up the project. And we submitted the notice of intent after many, many meetings together to decide what the best, what features of the area we would like to reveal and make it a pleasant place for people to come and visit and learn a little bit about the history of the area.
Any kiosks?
We've talked about, but not, yeah, okay. We plan, we've looked into placing a kiosk on the trail from the parking area into the center of the area, to placing a kiosk similar to those that we have at Fisher Lake and also Mineral Hills. And we've talked about placing some informative placards in the area, which would describe the both the cultural history of the area, the farming that went on there, and also the natural history of the area, and perhaps pointing out a couple of the major artifacts, excuse me, one of which I mentioned is this old horse-drawn hay tedder, which we came across. And the other is a sawmill, which was built by, as we understand, by the last people to live in, on the farm there, to cut wood to build one of the 2 houses that is along that line. So there's some interesting features. We've also found a lot of other stuff, a couple of horse collars, and bits and pieces of crockery, and pots and pans and so forth, which may not be of tremendous intrinsic value, but were certainly interesting to find on the grounds.
I forget who else was there when we walked where these trails were going to be, and I can't remember when that was last fall.
Yeah, I think it was September. Can't really remember. I think it was September.
I think we had a brush hogging or something.
Came in and did some hand siding.
Yeah.
A little bit of
sort of laying out
right on the little driveway area.
Yeah, there's some rust. Actually, I'm up that a little bit. Go over the whole case tractor. Same kind.
A couple of years ago, pulled several hundred pounds of stuff out of that.
Oh, it was a mess. Yeah. Yeah, the area had really gone to pot. And people had used it, evidently used it as a dump. I forget how many tires we got out of there. A whole stack of tires and little chains and gosh, I forget. Hoses. Tremendous amount of hose. It was a dump. And we got it cleaned up to a certain extent, but it's, you know, there's still stuff that has to be, excuse me, so it has to be cleaned up.
Well, it seemed like DEP had a number of things that they were wanting to see addressed, but it didn't seem like any of those were deal breakers.
So for the first one, we just got the, did you see National Heritage comments? Yes, we just got those.
Just, this one just came.
So the trail work can be a limited project, which is, which makes it easier for my riverfront area should be mapped. I didn't think it was necessary because it's all riverfront area. It didn't seem like we needed to know exactly where it was if it's all riverfront. You noted it could be a redevelopment project if there's enough farm machinery. I don't think there's enough farm machinery, but there weren't two houses there, so that this work is clearly less than
there's some than places clearly above that. There's just expansive areas where it's not a natural floor.
We did leave the foundation.
Some old foundation.
But the driveways were removed. And the herbicide treatment is already.
And they specified that November and April are the only times we can do the brush hogging.
Right, which was just exactly what we proposed.
Well, I other questions from commissioners, comments?
It's just a comment. It was great that the water department and DPW were willing to cooperate over the parking area because there's the sight lines pulling out of our property are really pretty. It's pretty dangerous, and it's too close to the National Grid.
We noticed that when people come screaming down. Comments or questions from the public?
Well, I'll add a comment. Lori Sanders, and although I'm not a member, well, I'm a member of Broad Brook Coalition, but 2 years ago, I did the inventory of the property on behalf of the city, and looking at the city comprehensively, I think one of the components that makes this particular property special and a nice location for a wildlife line, and to consider it almost like a parklet because of that historic alteration. If you look at all of the city, there are very few open marshes like this that have easy access. You have Arcadia, a little bit at Broad Brook, but Mature Lake, but you've got to really hump it. And so this is really one of the very few Willards, but that's private. So, and there are some extraordinary opportunities. So I just see it as a sort of beautiful opportunity for the city to have this gateway park, just a lovely in entering the city or exiting the city, and there's just lots of opportunities. And with respect to the brush hogging, in some ways I feel like that is a terrific component of the project because in the absence of brush hogging, all of that wood turtle habitat where they forage from June, July, and August is just going to grow up and forest, and actually we are enhancing wildlife habitat for special concern species. So as long as it's done, you know, in those discrete time periods, it's actually a bonus.
We were looking for some direction around the parking area, and I think we had some back and forth about that. We suggested putting down some rock, actually DPW suggested putting down some rock because they considered that it might get mushy.
Yeah, because the only part that's paved is the part that's right in front of the
circle. Yeah. Right. And of course, nothing is mushy at this time of year. And we were looking for some guidance on whether Natural Heritage had anything to say about putting any gravel down or putting gravel down
well,
as necessary.
It will be going on top of the current lawn. It's already disturbed. I don't know, Sarah, whether permeable surface would be that big a deal.
It's not in our jurisdiction because it is outside of river.
Thanks, Lori.
See, I think it is still within downtown. But they didn't, I mean, they had it in the application.
They didn't mention anything about it.
No, they didn't mention it. It's already grass. So if something is already grass, they
didn't. Yeah. But what's your feeling about the necessity of putting down gravel at all? I mean, should we try for a year and see how it holds up?
Maybe it would be a question of how much traffic we have to collect.
Right.
If it turns out, I guess my thought would be, if you're only getting one or two cars a week, there's no risk of going to the expense, and you're going to have to start finding the things. Trenches
stuff.
Done,
sure.
Right. Right.
So we can proceed with the, see how it goes.
As long as it's okay with the
water. Yeah, DPW they said it could be put down, but they didn't require it.
Curiously, they even plowed it last year, not having anything to do with us, but it was just part of their normal plowing, I guess, in the area. But that little parking area, which we designated, was nice and plowed.
Ideally, we could use the paved area, but I guess when they do get a delivery, they were afraid that any cars that might be in the way.
Yeah,
put a barrier halfway so that it wouldn't obstruct
access. They seemed pretty opposed to that. Just they didn't want to do it.
Yeah, they definitely did not want us to use the paper.
Yeah. Well, it would be our requirement if you took the negotiations with them about the use of that piece of land. As Sarah said, so we usually think of the lawn as an already integrated area. But this is an NOI, so we actually need to make a decision. Anybody have further questions, comments? Been out there and walked around, and that's a pretty good handle to what it's going to look like. It'd be interesting to see exactly how high the elevation requirement is and all that stuff. And then the bench, because we thought the bench would actually be nice to have it somewhere.
A little bit, elevated. Well, probably longer than that. I've just been immersed in the building of a new bridge at Fisherman Lake, and I thought that was going to go up like, you know, a snack.
Well, they're going to bring a crane and drop the bridge in, right? Didn't work like
it
that.
There's a lot involved in building something like that I haven't really figured together. It depends on how much time people have for it, and you know, whether it's a good job or something. We can also work on during the week.
Okay. The motion closed.
Motion to close.
Second.
Favor, aye. This is a piece of land we've been involved with, aware of, grateful that there's a community set up. And I have often been through my years on the commission organization advocating public access in a controlled and responsible way. We protect all these lands around the city. They don't get as much appreciated use by the companies as they think they should. So things like this, having trails and lines and places to place, especially in the marsh, it's pretty rare. It's exactly the kind of use we like to see. And it does represent an improvement over the pile of crap.
Yep.
It's interesting, but I remember when at least one of those houses was still there, it wasn't that long ago. So now that they're actually gone, and I don't think you have historic plaques about it.
With the natural heritage, which was in the application.
And we that there also come the continuing condition for the annual meetings of the Russian. Per the conditions of the shareholder. So that's a motion.
So people like to hang out by the Mill River and get very drunk and make a giant mess.
Down behind, what's that street?
Grove Avenue.
Grove Avenue.
So you can easily get to the river from the bike path, and also from the other side of the river, which I'll, another bike path, but we, it's a recognized problem and we don't have anything specific to be able to deal with it. And if we have something specific in our regulations, it's a lot easier to work with. You can probably speak to river issues in the state over the year.
Would you like me to?
Sure, if you'd like
to. Okay, well, my name's Jason Johnson. I live on 163 Main Street in Leeds. Third of the Mill River runs through my backyard. I actually have more of the Mill River in my backyard than is running down the main part of the channel across the street right now. With the extension of the bike path in Leeds, we had many comments and suggestions and to meetings about what we were going to do to proactively deal with greater access to that area, because the Chart Pack Dam, otherwise known as Orange Dam, was a really popular swimming pool. It's listed on several websites. People have been going there for a long time, and the word is out. Right across the street from my house, there's a another dam with a good swimming pool, and then you have Cook's Dam on the main part of our street. This past few weeks, we have 100, 200 people a day. They can't park up by Orange Dam. They're parking on Main Street. On Arch Street until that was recently reposted. The civic associations put out money to hire a police detail specifically to be there 4 hours to deal with traffic. We've been organizing garbage pickups and just been picking up bags and bags and bags of garbage. It's foul garbage. It's not all PET plastic bottles, maybe diapers. Chicken parts, barbecue grills. So we've had a good incumbents, with Wayne fighting about, you know, planning. What do we, how do we deal with this proactively? A great response from the police department. We met with the mayor last year, and then Hamp with the DPW. DPW is an acceptor of any maintenance responsibility beyond Mulberry Street for that portion of the road. So we've been taking on the heavy duty of picking up a lot of garbage and dealing with a lot of outside people. And they're not all Northampton people. In fact, the majority of them are coming from Chicopee and Springfield and Holyoke. They're coming from out of town. They're out of state license plates there all the time. So we're trying to really deal with this comprehensively. Yes, this, and I didn't hear about this before I saw it on the agenda, but what Wayne was proposing,
yes,
what
the, I think the is language in there. Is, okay. I think it's pretty much verbatim.
Yes, basically it's coolers, no coolers, and no fire, no grills.
I was curious why the diapers
were a problem.
Yeah, it's becoming a human health hazard. It's just an issue. You know, with it not having an end either, so it ends at dead ends at the town line in Williamsburg, you know, there is nowhere for people to go. And so if you're asking people to come and recreate and appreciate the river, which the River Greenway, we in Civic, we do. We want that. We want people to be utilizing the resource, but they also have to respect the resource. Because there's no mechanism for dealing with it. The city can't afford it. They're giving us some garbage bags, DPW is helpful, and planning has also been really helpful in providing us with ways to deal with it. The time, you know, I don't want to spend every weekend of my summer picking up this garbage. So I imagine that this is where this is coming from, and I hope that this will help. You know, we've been a proponent of signage, not having things in writing are good. They can lead to enforcement, I guess, is what the issue is.
And I think some weekends during the summer, like 4th of July weekend, it might just have to be closed because it's such a local issue.
Yeah.
And there's really no way to deal with it.
We've had people driving down there. The bollards aren't preventing cars from getting down there. So it really has taken a very...
People are actually driving down the bike?
People are driving down the bike, dragging material down there, and then usually leaving it down there. So this is an ongoing issue. I think that this is a way that the city is supporting it and helps with the enforcement end of it.
And at least so, now we can put up signs to say these things are not allowed.
Exactly.
And the police can take
example of that.
Okay,
that's
a good idea.
Yeah, it would be good. So this is sort of the ongoing work. So I'm supportive, I guess. I didn't intend to come here just being supportive of it, but since I'm the only one here, I am supportive of this. And I hope that the Conservation Commission, lends the whatever it takes to help improve these issues, because I think this is good for all of us.
Right. Yeah,
And I guess the other thing that I would say is that this is probably not limited to just this area. You know, that this could be.
We have intermittent issues that sort of move around, but that's the only one where it's really.
What's the mechanism once it says Wayne says okay, I can close this area?
We have to cooperate with the police or have somebody close the area. Which we can do a few times a year. We couldn't do it every single day. Like give people the idea, oh, people are actually watching us. Maybe we should try to behave.
My only other thought about this was as soon as you create something, you know, you realize all of the loopholes in it. And so glass bottles, I totally understand. I mean, we pick up a lot of plastic bottles and we pick up a lot of, you know, cans. So I guess the no alcohol component would cover the cans mostly.
Yeah, and we prohibit alcohol.
Right.
So that's perfect.
That's already covered.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the dog issues.
As issues with the state hospital have curtailed off-leash dog walking. We are seeing a lot of off-leash dog walking.
But that's included. I was looking. I'm trying to look at the entire land use regulations more broadly because this is being put in there for this specific issue.
So yeah, this specific
seems
area.
A little weird that we're just putting it into this. We should now understand the backstory.
Well, that's a good question, though. Is there any, if we just take out the deed, since I know we have these kind of regulations?
Or additional deeds number, remarry, or so, above the code?
Yes, in addition to the above regulations. So it's like Rainbow Beach, where you have different regulations.
So I guess I would just ask for, you know, jumping on it and doing something about it, since you just got it as well, that you would look at it and see if there are other overlapping areas, other conservation areas in the city where these issues are applicable, and if that wording is all good, then...
Well, one of the things that is an additional thing, including part of the land use regulations, is when you're having homeless people camping, fires overnight, and a whole bunch of stuff, but further down the road toward homelessness to Smith area, you got the neighborhood to say, look, if you see stuff, call the cops. And it didn't take too many times before they were not aware of what was moving.
Yeah, I can send some of the police wrote a report of the issue of the last, they dealt with over 100 people on Saturday, and Sunday was worse. So people are definitely being contacted. They would go from Orange by the time they got down to Main Street and down to Cooks and back up to Orange. It was a whole other group of people.
And
so
it's not the same people every weekend.
It's not the same people every weekend. And so it's going to take that sort of consistent contact. And we've talked to some neighbors about funding these extra police details and the civic over a couple days. But they're $100 per person per day, and they're expensive. We can't do that forever. So we're hoping that something can be drafted.
Well, this will allow signage.
This is the planning department
covering
for a couple of them.
Well, I guess this makes sense to me to do. Remain open to further regulation until the flip side of what I was saying about the public paths and community areas, until they want public use, but not public use. Things like this are going to hit you. You can't walk. You can't do anything. Do we need to say, or is it generic? Fires, rubbish, we already have the generic ones. So those can all be part of the signage.
Yeah.
Process.
There are swimming holes in the city. That's true.
Yeah, we
And they close the holes in the cars.
Yeah, it's getting all the pressure in the weeds there.
Just the river's so long, I'm surprised you can even swim in it.
Splash a little bit.
Splash, walk in and get wet. It's kind of wet.
So, and just the foraging item?
So the foraging, foraging is becoming a thing. So this makes it really clear that collecting and foraging for personal use is allowable, but commercial use is not allowed. So if someone from a restaurant is sending a forager to go and collect stuff, that's
coming from people selling
fiddleheads.
Ramps and fiddleheads. We had a lot of reports of people doing that this spring, like just walking around with buckets, just filling them with ramps.
Okay, I have.
Just because it only was berries and mushrooms, and it's for people eat a lot more stuff than that.
Berries, common mushrooms.
So I just said, I just opened up the universe to all edible plants.
All edible plants.
Yeah, so collection of edible plants for personal, non-commercial consumption only is allowed. It was very restrictive, like only berries and mushrooms, but this opens it up.
Plants and mushrooms. Is that going to be an issue?
And then the groups over 10 suggestion is just something that we already asked our user groups to do.
Is that a change?
It should
be blue. So the groups over 10 was already there, but we're just adding any group activity at any time that's open to the public plus credit the city.
So can you be getting on? That's not on this one.
Correction going.
You know, so
foraging is to plant because people don't know what the
as they were here, as well as the ones that are motorized vehicles.
So the motorized vehicles ones, I sent this out twice. So the motorized vehicles makes no change in policy. It just reflects what actually is allowed by deeds and other things.
So it's changing some of the names.
Probably just a human foraging is defined as a human collection because they want to scan.
Jason, the sawmill hellhorn is only a power line trail. And no one uses that and probably no one. Awful lot of them. But this doesn't, this is the property we just acquired across from the reservoir.
Yeah.
So this doesn't actually change anything.
Okay. Is it helping to deal with the Jeep clubs? No. Because they do come in.
On that time?
Yeah, they usually park right on the reservoir road and then they drive up.
Sylvester Road?
The 8-meter.
Yeah, so.
Trail.
Sylvester Road has been open and used always. So that this doesn't change anything.
Is that not for sure?
Yes. Okay. And then
is that planted by time of year or just the trail?
It never has been.
Yeah.
Not for the Jeeps because we've always restricted them to areas that have their bark.
Yeah.
If they're going off of that, then they're farther than they're supposed to be.
Yeah.
But not time. So the group's over at 10. We just ask people to give the Conservation Commission credit for owning the land. And let us know.
Oh,
so
I
we get, then let us know so we
in
can
their own
them.
Description of what they're doing
yeah.
for an organized trip.
Yep.
Back to this leaves and over river greenway. So you can post, I know I'm, like, there's an educational issue here.
Right now we couldn't post any of this because we don't specifically disallow it.
to post things like groups over 10?
Well, those are organized.
Right.
Or, so this isn't like a group of people going out on
nature walks. What I'm wondering is that, is there an issue of sort of excessive number of people? Because one of the issues of having so many people there is the degradation of the resource.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. It's hard to capture that. Because none of the people know each other. Right. Yeah. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. It's an issue
that if you have it in writing, so for example, there's, you can't have fires, you could add to that one description. I think I'd need a little more time to sit with this. I'm fine putting this in now, but it just seems so out of place. Here.
It is, but the problems there are also very, very different from anything.
Yeah, I get it. But would you be able to post that? Not just the things from that section, but all the things from the entire section?
Yes.
Yes.
Like dogs on a leash.
Sure.
Rubbish,
alcohol, beverages, rubbish, fire. So all that stuff applies specifically. What you're just trying to do is add a few more things.
Yeah. So you can't have diapers, polluted glass bottles.
So you can't have diapers.
And we didn't want to overall prohibit grills and stoves because sometimes people go camping and that's okay.
Right.
And it seems like the crucial piece is the wing be authorized to close in the area.
Important.
And that's a piece of language that we can
assist. Maybe diaper is only.
So bring your kids. But they're already, you already can't throw diapers. This would only be if the police went out there and said, hey, you got a bunch of diapers next to you. Like, this is.
They literally have to see somebody throw it, though, too.
Yeah.
In order to prosecute. To see somebody throw it, so it again adds the practicality of the enforcement issue.
And
very difficult.
Kids swimming in diapers are just gross.
Yeah.
Just...
And so it's not having any bathrooms. A small place next to a river.
Yeah.
So that would be the next step that I would like to see planning and trying to address in the conservation areas. And talks about that is, we rent a porta potty for a conservation area for the summer. How do we deal with that? It's an issue.
Well, and people can take their carload of whoever for a few bucks to the park and have access to the wave pool and all this stuff. That,
well, it costs a few bucks though.
No, it does. They just raised the rates too.
Did they?
Yeah.
How much?
I mean, it used to be $4 or $5.
Yeah.
Now it's like $7 or $9. Which is, it's a consideration for people.
Yeah.
They don't want to go. You go two times and that's.
It's a start. And these can be changed at any time, but this will at least provide us some.
Yeah, this is, we've always said this is kind of a living document as we add lands and see what kind of uses like that. So I'd say we need to vote on this one on the staff suggestions for the land use regulations. In the spirit of this being a new document and a static one, I think we will continue to revisit and modify some of these at any time. To approve? Is there a motion to approve? Kim has some concerns, so I won't expect you to leave the night.
I understand.
Somebody want to move?
That we accept this as revised.
And a second?
I'll second.
All in favor? Aye. Opposed? So moved.
All right. And a quick related thing under all other business not foreseen. So very much related to this issue. Sharkpath has a lot of property that they don't know about. They might not own it. They might own it. They're working on figuring out if it's actually theirs through a detailed title search. But we've approached Sharkpath to possibly acquire some land below the dam on the other side of the river, if it actually is theirs. There's management issues, but we already have the management issues. This would provide some additional leverage to be able to deal with them. And it may be a donation. We have no idea at this point, but just a general approval to move forward with that.
To alert us to the fact that those negotiations are going on. You don't need money then.
Yeah.
No, no. We may never need money for that. And Broad, so we are currently working on acquiring this parcel of land, which is important because it would actually provide a link from North Farms Road all the way to Route 9, which we currently don't have.
Which one again?
It's this one. And it's got this weird, like, narrow strip. So currently we're thinking 46,600 is 20 acres. But this is something we've been looking for a long time. We have no idea of funding sources at this point. It's pretty preliminary. But just like a.
Just Oregon, we had some Route 9 when you were set up there?
So Route 9 is here. This is the big river project.
Okay, that's North Farms.
Yeah, so this is its parcel. So then we'll connect all the way.
Okay.
Somebody has to move to work with that.
Huh?
Or both of them, just to vote. Does that work?
Both.
Both the potential chart pack and the North Farms for a bunch.
What do you think?
I don't understand the chart pack, what we would be.
We're just authorizing the
chart.
Negotiations.
To keep moving forward.
In both cases, right?
Yes.
We don't have prices, we don't have deals, we don't have terms.
And you wouldn't make a decision unless we had a discussion about it.
Right.
Not for this one. So here's the. This is the assessor line, which doesn't necessarily mean anything. The old properties, they tend to get really confused, and also there was a very large flood here a while ago. So Chartpack wasn't really aware that they actually owned all of this land. We definitely wouldn't want the dam. We have no interest in the dam and that liability. But owning a right-of-way or land from Mulberry Street along the river. And it would help the village of Leeds as well.
Would help them?
The village of Leeds as well. So all of these things that you just approved for the land use regulations would apply here too. But now it's all on private property. So it, even if we trespass people from our property, they could just go over here and sit there.
I'll make a motion that we negotiate this.
So both of those parcels, some they're not exactly parcels, both of those areas, whether they're being purchased or right away or pretty open-ended. Yeah. A second for that?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Anything else?
Montview, they'll come back next time. They weren't.
Thank you very much for your consideration.
Well, thank you
for your ongoing cooperation.
We have the May 2016 landfill water quality report, if anybody wants that. We have Tennessee Gas Pipeline will be doing maintenance on their Northampton lateral pipeline. So it's basically tree cutting. National Grid is taking down some hazard trees. And we got a nice letter from the Secretary of Environmental Affairs that after we advocated for continued funding of the Working Forest Initiative, which is forest stewardship plans and those forestry grants and those type of things, that they gave all the funding back. So it had been completely cut from this year's budget. So I wrote a letter saying it
should be.
I gave it all back.
Nice.
Well done.
Hey,
it sometimes works. Sometimes. Wow. And if it
doesn't, you don't get a letter. Right. Okay. And that's it. Well, so right now we're holding the date, and we ought to find out in a week or two whether we'll be used.
Yes.
In August.
That was surprising, because the water quality certification is usually enough for the Corps of Engineers to say, okay, this is
fine. I don't know. There's some part of the story.
Yeah, I don't know.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All right.